Thank you all for coming. I appreciate your time and effort to learn more about this, and we hope that that you'll find it interesting and inspiring as well. Next slide, please. So you've already heard a little bit about the Bank of North Dakota, and the very important point about public banking is that what banks do is they create credit. They really make money through what is known as fractional reserve lending. So commercial banks take depositors' money, and they're able to lend a multiple of those deposits out to the public. And you've heard about credit, as I mentioned, fractional reserve lending means that you're allowed to lend more money out than you actually have on deposit. And right now the commercial banks are making a lot of money doing this. And in North Dakota, they have learned the secret of fractional reserve lending and have taken it over for the public's benefit. You can see that what North Dakota has done is expand public services, they've lowered taxes, and they're also able to increase the bank's capital to make even more credit available to the people in North Dakota. Next. So the Bank of North Dakota is also a very profitable institution, and that's a question that a lot of skeptics have is gee, if you have this public bank not run by these high-fluting bankers, how can you make any money? Well, in 2013, the Bank of North Dakota earned a 21.4% return on equity by investing within the state. It's a fantastic return on equity. It's almost unheard of. In fact, the Wall Street Journal several months ago had an article about the Bank of North Dakota, and it said that it has a higher rate of return on equity than Goldman Sachs. It is a powerful economic growth engine because it makes so much money for the state. They have been contributing about $30 million throughout the 2000s per year to the state's general fund. Last year, the economy of North Dakota is doing so well that the legislature told the Bank of North Dakota just to keep the $94 million that they were going to transfer to the general fund, because they were already running a very large surplus in their budget. North Dakota budgeted $60 million in revenue from the Bank of North Dakota for the biennium budget years of 2013. And as I mentioned, they had a profit of $94 million. So if this state-owned bank is so profitable, why are we not following that model? Why are we still using a Wall Street bank to deposit all of our state revenue in and giving that institution the power to create credit instead of retaining that power ourselves? Because after all, what we really do virtually is we deposit our revenue into the commercial banks, and then we borrow it back from them at a much higher multiple than what we're making on those deposits. So we now know the secret, and it's a matter of just putting that into practice. Looking at the Bank of North Dakota's balance sheet for 2013, they had about $500 million in equity. Their loan portfolio was $3.5 billion, student loans about $1 billion, Commercial loans, $1.4 billion, residential loans, about $700 million, and agricultural loans were $361 million. So you can see by the loan portfolio and the amounts that are loaned out, how the Bank of North Dakota is helping the people of North Dakota. They had $5.6 billion in deposits, another $2.5 billion in securities. So it's a very, very healthy bank as well. So if we want to compare the two states, Arizona and North Dakota, we look at on the left-hand side, Arizona had in 2009 had an operating loss of $480 million. The 2014 budget deficit was $470 million. State debt as of 2013 was $9.7 billion. Debt service on that debt, $742 million. Unemployment as of 2013 was 8.2%. We are one of the top 10 states for home foreclosures. Almost 50% of mortgages in the state in 2011 were underwater. And we lost 10 community banks in between 2010 and 13. On the other side, state budget surpluses in North Dakota from 2008 to 2013. The 2012 surplus, $1.6 billion. You can see it on the unemployment as of the third quarter of 2013, 2.9%, the lowest in the country, has the lowest foreclosure rate, has the most local banks per capita, as Pam mentioned, there are 88 as of fiscal year, 88 financial institutions as of the third quarter of last year. No bank failures in over 10 years. The other day, I was at a meeting and a skeptic said, well, why do we want to create a bank that competes with private banks or commercial banks? And actually, what we find is that we already have an uneven playing field in the banking industry, because we have Wall Street banks who have, not only do they have much deeper pockets, they have a lot more funds to operate with, a lot more funds to compete for depositors' monies, more funds to provide better services that community banks can't provide. And most importantly, they have access to the Federal Reserve window. So they can borrow money at the absolute cheapest rate of any financial institution in the country. Community banks do not have access to the Federal Reserve window, so they have to borrow money from those very same Wall Street banks that are competing with them. So you can imagine if you have to pay four times the amount that your competitors are paying for the product that you're selling, which is money, it's very hard to compete. Also, it's hard for them to compete for depositors as well. They don't have the marketing budget that Wall Street banks do. And so as a result, we see a dwindling number of financial institutions in Arizona. Now, if we look at cash flow Arizona, it's another graph of it. You can see down below a little plumber is working. He pays his taxes to the state, $100 in revenue. That flows into the state treasury. And from there, it flows into what's known as the servicing bank. The servicing bank is a private institution, as we've been talking about before. The servicing bank has the ability to create credit because the state treasury has given its all of the public monies to the servicing bank. What happens with the funds that are deposited in the servicing bank by the state treasury is that accounts are there for such as school districts. The state of Arizona account pays about 1% by the Bank of America, as Steve mentioned earlier. So the $100 flows into TUSD, TUSD uses that $100 to educate our plumber. Now the plumber finds work because Jane Doe needs a plumber, and she doesn't have the $900 that it takes to hire the plumber to do the work for her, so she gets her credit card out, her Bank of America credit card out, and borrows it from the same financial institution, which has created the $900 from the $100 that the state deposited into the bank. The $900 just came from fractional reserve lending, and we have given that magic to create money away. And we really don't need to do that. So what about the statutes on the way that the state operates? What is some of the obstacles to doing this? Well, first of all, you can see highlighted in the top line, it's very clear that community banks are not going to be institutions to become the servicing bank for the state. The capital structure of the bank has to be at minimum of $10 million. There has to be assets of $200 million. So you're not going to have a community bank with those kinds of assets. It's going to be a Wall Street bank. However, we find that statute does not require the state treasurer to use a servicing bank. And so because of this item G in the statute, we believe that the state treasurer has a very large opening there to create a bank for the state and thereby retain our ability to create credit, not having to borrow money from Wall Street banks at exorbitant rates while we're earning a pittance on our deposits. Now, to shift away a little bit about the investment policy statute, these requirements pretty much codify the fact that the state is not going to be earning very much money on their revenue. You can see that in the green here, the investment policy of the investment company or the investment trust, which the state is going to do business with, has to try to maintain a constant share price. Now, those of you who know a little bit about investing know that one of the ways in which you make money investing is the price of the share that you bought goes up. That's how you make money. But the state is required to buy mutual funds whose objective is to have a constant share price. They're only going to be depending on dividends for earnings, and we're just not going to make very much money. We also found in this investment policy statute is that the state can buy municipal bonds of Arizona. That 2 years ago, the city needed funds to repair its roads, and so it held a bond election, and we approved $100 million bond issue to repair our streets. First of all, it's an indication of what poor financial condition the city is in that we have to borrow money in order to just maintain our infrastructure. We should have the revenue to do that without having to go and borrow money just for routine maintenance. This bond election authorized an interest rate on those bonds of up to 8%. So here we are, the city, depositing our funds in that same servicing bank that the state treasurer is using, earning 1%, 2%, and then we have to go and borrow that money back from that same bank for as much as 8%. It makes no sense to the public, but it makes a lot of sense if you're a private banker. So we feel that right there, the state could make a dramatic improvement in the municipalities just by buying the municipal bond obligations that the municipalities are holding and paying high interest rates on. So again, you know, where did the states invest? Wall Street versus Main Street. Arizona investing in U.S. government bonds, corporate bonds, exchange-listed stocks, exchange-listed money market securities, repurchase agreements with Wall Street brokerages. Those repurchase agreements practically guarantee that we're not going to make any money on our investments, because in that arrangement, I'm investing in, say, the American bond fund or the American funds, and I make an agreement that whatever happens with that investment, American funds will buy it back from me for what I paid for it. So I really eliminated any risk that I'm holding, and I'm not going to have what's called a risk premium for my return. So the state is, by having such an extremely safe investment policy, guarantees that we're not going to make much money. On the other hand, in North Dakota, with, again, the arrangement, I'll tell you a little bit about the arrangement for the Bank of North Dakota with the community banks. So the Bank of North Dakota serves as the banker's bank. It's a wholesale bank where community banks can access capital at the lowest rate in the country because the Bank of North Dakota has access to the Federal Reserve. If the Bank of North Dakota needs more capital to lend, it can go to the Federal Reserve window and borrow money at 0.25%. So those community banks are no longer relying on Wall Street banks to fill any capital requirements that they have. They can go to the Bank of North Dakota if they need to and get money at nearly the same rate as Wall Street banks. They also have the luxury of having their loans underwritten by the Bank of North Dakota. So, for instance, if I have a student, I'm a banker, I'm a loan officer, I have a new graduate from the university, comes in, has a good solid business plan, he wants to start a business. I can lend him $250,000 under a loan program that has been fashioned by the Bank of North Dakota, and I don't have to be too concerned about him defaulting on that loan because I know that the Bank of North Dakota is underwriting 60% of that risk. Okay? So I'm getting capital at a very cheap rate from the Bank of North Dakota. I know that not all of my loan is at risk, and you can imagine what the benefit is to the young people who want to start out, have a great idea for a business. There's also the issue of farm lending. Now, if you look at the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation's financial institutions sheets that come out quarterly, and you look at agricultural lending in Arizona, we don't find any agricultural lending in Arizona. I don't know how it is that farm property is being exchanged in this state. I also can't imagine what it would be like to be somebody who grows up on a farm, wants to start a farm, maybe even went to college, and you go to a bank and say, well, I'd like to start up my own farm. In Arizona, you would be told, what do you have for collateral? What can you collateralize the loan with? If they were JP Morgan Chase or Wells Fargo, that would be the question that young person would be hearing. Not so in North Dakota, because in North Dakota, they have a lending program, again, administered through the community banks, so that the community banks are profitable, writing lots and lots of loans, okay? And these young farmers can get a loan to start up a farm, $750,000. That's the loan program for a new farmer. If for existing farmers, if they need to upgrade their equipment, the same loan program will apply. So you can see how this public bank is such a dynamic economic engine for North Dakota. So let's turn our attention, because we have a strategy whereby we're trying to get a bank started on the state level, but it could be done at the city level as well. So based upon the latest financial report for the city of Tucson, the city of Tucson's net worth is about $2.5 billion. In 2014, or the 13-14 fiscal year, it had revenues of just under $1 billion, the city did. So if you have a stream of income, you can calculate what is the capital value that must be there to create that stream of income. So if $995 million is 4% of some sum of money, you can do the calculation and see that that sum is almost $25 billion. And I think that that stream of income, that taxing authority, can be used to claim as an asset to start up a municipal bank. We also have the $2.5 billion of hard assets for the city. So one can argue that the capitalization value of the city of Tucson is about $27.4 billion. So with that capitalization, the city of Tucson, and this is how it works in North Dakota, in the Bank of North Dakota, is that politicians are not running the bank. The board of directors of the bank are elected by a diverse group of elected officials, again, being very careful to have arm's length from those directors. And that board of directors, in turn, hires the director of the public bank. So this is not, we're not going to have city councilmen making loans. Okay? So after the city of Tucson would form, after the city of Tucson would form this, the board of directors, it could apply to the U.S. Office of the Comptroller of the Currency to become a bank. The Comptroller of the Currency is the federal agency that is charged with chartering banks. After it does that, it could apply to the Regional Federal Reserve Bank in San Francisco to open a line of credit using that $27 billion in assets as collateral. Once it has established that line of credit with the Federal Reserve Bank, I think that it could start buying back the bond obligations that they're paying 3-4% on, and greatly reduce the debt service that the city is burdened by right now, reducing the amount of money that's left over to provide service. And that's why we don't have the funds to repair our roads. This cycle of indebtedness that is happening in the city, I don't think there is any way back from it. Unless there is some new car manufacturer that all of a sudden decides to come and locate here. And
we tried it already, it didn't work.
It's not going to happen. There is no silver bullet except for this one, and that is taking control of our ability to create credit. So once the bank is established and capitalized, then it would create relationships with community banks in Tucson and establish the same kind of loan programs that we've been talking about that North Dakota has. Under those loan programs, if I'm a businessman, an existing businessman, I want a new fleet of trucks, or I want to expand the services, I have a new product, I can go to that community bank with that good idea and get some credit to grow my business. Because the situation that we have currently is that we are dominated by Wall Street banks. Those Wall Street banks are taking all the capital, a great deal of the capital from our community out of the state, out of our city, to Wall Street. And they're not lending here. And that's the reason why we have such severe economic stagnation here. So you create these loan programs, community banks would become healthy again, we wouldn't see them disappearing, but we begin to see them thriving. The relationships with to have loan guarantees for small businessmen, students, agriculture, entrepreneurs. And it could create a student loan consolidation program, for instance. It could buy student debt, because bank debt is an asset of the bank. It's like dual bookkeeping, where debt is an asset and a liability for the, you know, for the financial institution. So it could really grow its assets pretty quickly just by through the community bank programs offering credit at much lower rates than people are currently having to labor under. Okay, so again, other assets that bank could get were underwater home mortgages, where what you're paying your loan on is for the value of a house that's much greater than it is today. You can't sell the house, so you owe more than the house is worth. We know that whole story. We can also refinance credit card debt. I don't know why we couldn't do that. Why would we have, you know, hundreds of thousands of people in Tucson carrying debt at 18, 20, 25% when they don't have to? Because if we take that power of creating credit and create our own financial institution, we could offer to buy that debt from people, and you could have, again, administered through professional loan officers who can also get credit reports, make sure that people aren't just taking that money and going into deeper debt, or, you know, whatever. You can, you know, there are ways to do that. We can create student loan programs. That would help the university. And we can finance public school programs. For Pete's sakes, where are we going to go with these schools that every year have less and less money to operate with and have to compete with charter schools that are not burdened with the same regulations that our public schools are? And it can increase the value of the city of Tucson assets, those same assets that it used to initially collateralize our bank, making them more valuable, improving the city parks, improving city transportation, creating an expanded Sunlinks program, for instance, running that new modern streetcar all the way to Colb Road down Broadway, or all the way up, you know, up here. It could, you know, there's just an unlimited amount of things that could be done to improve the community if we had the capital that we needed. And we can do that by taking it back from the Wall Street banks. To summarize, we're handing that ability to create credit over to the Wall Street banks, not investing here in Tucson. Deposits begin the creation of a credit in the bank. This credit is an asset of the bank. Again, you know, that's going way back. We've already talked about that the city would not have to use a rainy day fund, would not have to be looking all over the place for cash in order to collateralize the start of the bank, because it already has quite a bit of collateral. Invest in Main Street through a public bank, keeps our tax money working within the state, keeps our credit from leaving the state. Strengthens community banks. This cannot be stressed enough. In North Dakota, 56 of their 88 financial institutions are subchapter S corporations. What that means is that those are corporations that are so small that they have a very limited number of shareholders. The revenue in those banks passes through to the principals. It's a very salient fact about, you know, how true those are, those community banks in North Dakota. Extremely healthy. And by the way, if you look at the amount of capital that is retained by the financial institutions in North Dakota versus the state of Arizona, you can look at a per capita sum of money. So for each individual, how much money is held in the financial institutions in the states? In North Dakota, the per capita assets held in financial institutions is almost $37,000. In Arizona, it's less than $3,000. $2,690 per individual in Arizona. And I would use that as an argument if the Wall Street banks tried to claim that they're not moving their capital out of the state, that they're leaving it here. Not so, because you know, just by looking at those FDIC reports, you can see what is happening with the financial institutions that are operating in your state. I don't know how many years it will be if we continue down this road. Well, we won't have any community banks anymore. We will be completely dominated by Wall Street banks who have fair trade agreements. They all belong to the same country clubs. We're not going to do well unless we do something soon. We're going to raise taxes, cut services, sell assets, or invest in our own citizens by creating a public bank. So, you know, do we refine and pass a resolution? We work with Steve and hopefully get a bill through the state legislature to create a state bank. We work with the mayor and council to show them how the city can be relieved of their debt burden by creating a municipal bank, a publicly owned municipal bank. So we need to find some natural allies as well. Pam and I need to find, with your help, a financial institution, a community bank that understands what we're talking about and understands that they, you know, their difficulty in competing with Wall Street banks is reasonable because they're just out-capitalized. So we think that we can find a partner with a community bank who can go with us to Phoenix and tell the state legislature, look, this isn't healthy. This isn't healthy for the state. It's not healthy for the financial institutions that are operating in the state. And we need to get a public bank. Again, natural allies are those community bankers, the unemployed, underemployed people, small business owners in particular. They know better than anybody else how hard it is to get a loan at a rate that is sustainable for them. You know, so that's pretty much the story. So thank you very much.